Okay, well, I can introduce Professor Herrera. He is one of the highly cited researchers, not only for 1 or 2 years, consecutively for almost 10 years. And I'm very happy, in fact, or more than happy to have him. He's more than friends and colleagues, and also very good, dedicated scientist, not only to the research, but also to his students. You see a lot of leaders in science, especially in high impact research project, are graduated or supervised by his work. And I'm very glad that he joined this conference and accept the invitation, though I know he's very busy because he's been selected as the vice mayor of Granada City and doing research for research and development. I think he will talk about this. And also he published a good papers. I think he's also the editor-in-chief of Information Infusion, who has a big role in his leadership to increase the impact factor to an impressive number. So Professor Herrera, welcome. And I appreciate it truly you accept the invitation of the conference on behalf of all the organizing committee of the people joining this event. I appreciate your time and also appreciate your effort in doing your research excellence presentation into this event. Thank you so much again. So please go ahead.
Thank you very much. Hamido really is, you are a good friend, and thanks for the invitation and thanks for the opportunity to present my recent studies and my work. I will share the slides. Let me. I'm sorry. I must put the first one. Well, the talk is focused on data quality for learning, with the objective to show you the importance of the quality data. The to work towards data quality is fundamental in order to obtain really top or high quality knowledge in the different in any problems. Particularly, I will pay attention to the case of the COVID prediction with radiography. I will show you some results and the current problems as consequence of the low quality of the data and the bad decision. In the two cases of study that I want to present you to show you as to focus the attention, knife detection in the video and COVID, I will use deep learning as the learning technology. And then I want to, the outline of my talk has basically two parts. The first part, I will introduce the concept of deep data and big learning, try to play with the big data and deep learning. In this case, I combine the words in order to introduce the context. And then I will introduce two cases of study to show you this idea. First, the first step, deep data. What is the concept that I want to introduce a deep data? First, in the trip towards data quality, let me to focus the attention. If we want to take quality decisions, we need to obtain quality models, quality patterns, quality rules. And of course, any quality decision is based on quality data. It's fundamental. Then if we want to take quality decisions, we need to get quality models, top technology, and then the base is the quality data. You know the classical slide that we use always in computation in general, garbage in, garbage out. It's the classical paradigm in computation. If we have garbage data, if we have low quality data, finally we will have a garbage results. In the same way, if we have perfect data, quality data, but we have a garbage model, the consequence finally will be the same garbage results. We need really excellent data, excellent models in order to get the knowledge. In this way, I use the deep data concept as the step to get more data quality for better knowledge. And the idea is to use technology to increase the quality of the data to get the in the path towards data quality. Always, when we start a project with a company, we need to analyze the quality of the data, and we need to use big data per processing, data per processing techniques to transform the raw big data, the classical data, into the data quality. And using the concept, currently we use the concept of smart data. We discuss or we use the expression of smart data when we are discussing about the top quality data that we can use in any problem after the transformation. In this way, in any problem, in any real problem, we need to analyze the data, and as we call here the big data. We need to use to analyze the if we have imperfect data, missing value, or so on. We must analyze if we have a high volume of data, if we can reduce to avoid the redundancies. We need to analyze the any kind of problems that we can find the data, the missing value, and so on. We need to use big data preprocessing, data preprocessing in general, to get the path toward data quality, and finally we get a smart data. When we have smart data, then we can use the learning algorithms to extract knowledge. This is fundamental, and now smart data is a fundamental concept in this path. In this way, towards data quality, we can discuss about two scenarios. The big data scenario. In the big data scenario, we have three fundamental elements: quality data, algorithms, sorry, scalable algorithms, and of course the technology, the cloud and the cluster, the Hadoop ecosystem to develop the algorithms. In the particular deep learning scenario, it's fundamental also to discuss about quality data, image, usually data augmentation, big data protection, and so on. In this case, the algorithms we are discussing about deep learning, neural networks, convolutional network, neural networks algorithms, and we are using technology, and in this case, the technology usually is the GPU technology. In both scenario, deep learning or big data scenario, we have always the three fundamental elements: the data, the quality data, the algorithms, scalable algorithms, and the technology, GPU, or the Hadoop ecosystem usually. But in all cases, the quality of the data is fundamental. Really, in any real scenario, working with the real problem, we are discussing always about big data. Please, sorry, I need to close the window because there is a noise. I don't know if you receive, Hamido, are you receiving some noise outside? I think so. I will close, sorry. This is the problem online and the direct online at home. In any classical scenario, we are discussing about the data, the big data, the artificial intelligence, and we have two fundamental steps: smart data to get smart data, quality data, and second, to extract the knowledge. Really, the classical scenario is first we use artificial intelligence algorithms, data preprocessing algorithms to get the smart data, and then the combination of the smart data together with the machine learning, we start the knowledge and we develop the application. This is the classical scenario. And in this scenario, always we are discussing about deep data as the way from the classical, the initial data towards the data quality for the better knowledge. This is the first step when we analyze a real problem. The second I call big learning, but this combination of the, in this case, the deep learning algorithms, convolutional neural networks with the data quality. Of course, all you are familiar with artificial neural networks. I don't need to explain anything about that. Also, you are familiar with convolutional network. It's a special kind of deep learning when we combine, we have different steps, convolution, pooling, and finally a full connected neural networks in order to process images, but also time series and so on. Really now CNNs are used in any kind of problem. In this scenario, we have different problems. For example, the classification, the object detection. After a classification phase, we can detect objects in an image, getting the boss first with the object and then to classify the object. And also we have problem of image instance segmentation and so on. In all the real scenario when we use the CNNs, we require usually large amount of data. It's fundamental. We need a lot of data to get the better accuracy. The practical solution to get the small data, the deep data, really we need the original the quality data, but we need sometimes the original data and a small data set, and you know that we need to use artificial data. We need to use usually data augmentation, any kind of techniques to increase the data set. And another special aspect is the transfer learning. When we have not so much data, transfer learning is essential and it forms part of the concept of the big learning. Always, when we are working with the deep learning algorithms, the data augmentation is a usual option to increase the number of the instance. But of course, we must take care because we can decrease the quality of the results because we have the problem of the noise and overfitting. Then we need to have a balance between the small data quality, and also the models, the learning models. Some kind of models of data augmentation, you know, scaling the data, centering the data, translation, rotation, and so on. Here you can find some example of the MNIST classical database. The other practical solution is a transfer learning. I will show you some results with transfer learning. Really, as you know, transfer learning is a machine learning technique that we start with a pre-trained model, and we use the well-known fine-tuning process in order to tune the model in order to get a new model for the problems. I call big learning as this combination of the deep learning and the transfer learning. And in any real application, we need to consider this both scenario. Then we are discussing about deep data and big learning as this scenario when we combine data preparation techniques, including data augmentation to get the small data, the data quality. And also we combine machine learning techniques, deep learning in particular now in my talk, and transfer learning in order to learn from a small set of data to get high quality models. Then the fundamental idea, more data quality for better knowledge, and to use together the deep data and big learning as approach to solve this problem. Let me now to introduce two cases of study, to show you two cases of study. The first case of study, night detection in video, I combine the both ideas, the deep data, the data quality together to the big learning. I will show you the problem and the process that we follow to solve this problem. And the second case of study, the COVID probably the COVID pandemic and the detection with the radiography. And I will show you some problems in the literature when people don't use the quality data and the correct database. And finally, I will finish with some remarks from these two case studies. Well, the first case of study, night detection. This particular problems belongs to the project. The project is a weapon detection alarm in video surveillance. It's a project with our objective is to develop a fast and accurate arms detection in models in video. Always in the different problems that we have studied in this context, we have in the methodology to create database in this case knife and non-knife, and we need to create a top quality database and a small data database, and to develop the deep learning model, to learn and to detect the knives versus other objects, for example, a pencil and mobile and so on, any object that you can use with in the hand. This approach belongs to the project that the future of the smart security really depend of this kind of approach to have the video surveillance to use artificial intelligence to detect any kind of weapon in a video in order to send an alarm. We have developed a different approach in this area. We started our project 4 years ago when we published this paper. This paper was published in archive, the first paper about in what pistol, the first paper that we published in archive received the recognition at the BEX paper in by the MIT Technology Review Journal as the best paper about technology in the week when it was published. Later, the paper was published in neurocomputing. After this paper, when we were detecting pistol, we developed different approach, and the second one was knife detection. I want to show you what happened when we start with a classical deep learning model. BGG 16 is the classical one, you know, and without fine tuning. The idea was to learn from scratch, fitting the weights through the backpropagation test. We started with a small database, and with our database, we have 178 knives and 138 non-knives. It was a small database, and we ran the deep learning algorithm. The results was, this was the accuracy, normal, but our surprise was the following. You can check that different objects obtain a high level of detection associated to the knife. In this case, was our surprise, the cat, due to the image were detected like as a knife. Was our surprise because really to detect a knife is so difficult, and if we consider the form, it is possible to find a lot of false positive. Our second experiment was with using deep learning, using fine tuning, and using transfer learning fine tuning. We find that after to use transfer learning using the classical transfer learning for the classical big image dataset, with that immediately the previous cases were detected as no knife. Really, when we have a very small dataset, the first conclusion is always it's better to use transfer learning to work with the classical deep learning from the context of big learning. I introduce it because transfer learning will avoid a lot of false positive. And this was our approach to use to the first model from the ImagineNet training, and then to adapt with transfer learning in this scenario. You can check that the score, F1 score, increased toward 0.95. Previously, the score was 0.81. Really, the using transfer learning, using fine tuning is fundamental when you have a very small data set. Of course, you have always some false positive, but because it depends on the form of the object. But I will show you the real scenario. In the real scenario, when we try to detect a knife, we have another problem is the bite next condition in any real scenario. And when you have the brightness condition, sometimes you don't detect the knife. And this is the we have a high brightness, it's so difficult to detect the knife. We need, you can here find in this image, the model, the deep learning don't detect the knife, but you increase the you have a low brightness, you have contrast, you can detect the knife. And a previous study, we were checking the different brightness condition, high, medium, low, and we introduced artificial brightness with contrast algorithms, and we were checking that if we control the brightness, really we can increase the quality of the models. Really, we need to pre-process the image. We need to introduce more and more image in a correct contrast and brightness in order to increase the quality of the models. The movement also generating noise and distortion, and it's so difficult to detect the knife in a real scenario. Here you can find some images when it is impossible now to detect the knife. Then our proposal was to analyze the darkening and the contrast of the image, to introduce the darkening factor in the database, to transform the image, first using data augmentation to increase the number of images, second using the data preprocessing to introduce a darkening factor in the image to transform the image. In this way, we have data quality, and we use some deep learning algorithms with the data with transfer learning to learn in the model. In this way, our methodology was to include data quality via data augmentation and transformation and data preprocessing and and to introduce transfer learning to improve the quality of the model. Here you have you can check the original data when we have no detection. We introduce the preprocessing and we have a detection, the degree is 0.7, and with the top quality data set, small data with top data quality, and with the data preprocessing, really we got the detection is near to 1.0 the probability. I will show you a video. This is the video in the real scenario. You can check that sometime out of time we don't detect the knife. Really, only we can find only a few box when we really detect the knife. In the next video, after our the cold methodology with the data quality and with the transfer learning, but basically data quality, because here we are using transfer learning, but the error is very clear. You can check that we don't detect usually the knife. Well, now you can check that in the next video, really we detect with more frequency the knife. When we introduce the contrast, we introduce the artificial contrast in the image because we are pre-processing the image always. In our methodology, we pre-process the image, introducing darkening, a darkening factor in the learning process, and also darkening factor in the preprocessing process, we can check that now the quality data is really fundamental to detect the knife. Here you can check in the real scenario when really you are, these are a video in our research centers, in the hall of our research centers, and you are checking that really if a person appears with a knife, this is my PhD student, Alberto, immediately we can detect the knife. Really, the current algorithms combining the transfer learning together the data quality, really, the model is a top model detecting the knife. Well, this was the first case of study, the knife detection, when really is fundamental the combination to combine the quality of the data, the data quality processes together with the transfer learning. The second case of study is focused now in a recent problem, COVID, the COVID detection with using radiography. Really, from the beginning of pandemic, really, up in the classical and the well-known journal, Radiology is the top journal in the area. Some doctors published papers when they use the chest radiographic to find the COVID, the positive patients. Was an interesting paper published last year, 1 year ago, when they proposed the radiology severity stratification, they called the COVID rail methodology. The idea was to divide, as you can check in the image, the chest to divide in different regions. We have four regions for each one in the lung where the texture radiography is transformed or it is divided in eight sections. Each lung is divided or in four parts in order to detect the different levels of the COVID is in the lung. And depending the how it affects the COVID, we have the normal without any kind of affection to the lungs and the maximum after more than six regions is the complete affection to the lungs and is the really the severe, the really very, very severe patients. This study was a handmade study by the doctors that they saw the utility of the this methodology to develop different algorithms to detect the COVID. In this way, I was working with my team developing a methodology based on chest X-ray image. Our approach is an approach based on small data. A data quality process was fundamental. In fact, we call our model COVID SDNet, a smart data net. Focus the attention on the data quality. We have a complete process to transform the original image, as you have here in the slide, to have finally first top quality image with the lungs, as you can check here. The segmentation is fundamental to focus the area on the lungs first, and second, the preprocessing, the data preprocessing. And this is very important. This aspect is very important, this image, because I will show later, I will show really what happened when people confuse the data set and use low quality data set. It's very important to focus the attention on the lungs, of course. The second step in our methodology, small data net methodology, is the process of data quality process, the data preprocessing with the GANs. We increase the data augmentation. Our data augmentation was using GAMs to transform the lungs image. And from that original image, we obtain always different image with the GAMs that using the contrast with negative and positive image. We transform the original data set to a new data set with this kind of image. In this scenario, we have a final step, the last step, number three, the learning with a double image. We combine the difference, the difference CNN models in order to have a final prediction. Our model present a very high score on moderate and severe severity and low score on mild severity. Remember that mild severity is this case when we have only two segments with the detecting the COVID. Here you can find the results. On the right you have the results. Mild 60%, moderate 84%, and severe 97%. In the average, we are better results than the result provided by the doctors. The model is good, but the model is around an average between 8% approximately, 8.82, depending of the data set. And we have a public data set, is COVID GR data set. This is our data set that you can get. The data set is now in our website. And we are increasing the number of images in the data set. Well, our result is good. The doctor, we are working with a doctor, the coordinator, one of the doctor, Martin Rodriguez, is the responsible of radiology area in the hospital, clinical hospital in Granada. And he told me our results are excellent. And in fact, the paper received an excellent comment by the reviewers, was published at the end of last year in the well-recognized journal of IEEE, Journal of Biomedical and Health Informatics. But the question is, what happened with the other deep learning models that you can find in the literature? If we check some paper here, there are two papers, for example, you can find that people say, we get 95%, 98%, really. People propose model with results near to the probability near to one to detect the COVID. It's quite different than our results. In fact, if we consider the models that these people publish and with our data set, we check that really in our data set, the sensitivity and prediction is very low. Really, this model, people provide the code, the implementation of these models, the results are really, the quality is low. Was a surprise for us because really the well-known model in the literature obtain very bad results in our data set. What is the problem? What is the problem that what does the scientific literature sometimes give results between 19 and 95% approximately? Recently, two Italian guys research published in the journal I am editor in chief this paper, a critic evaluation of methods for COVID automatic detection from accurate image. In fact, this paper was published in archive in June last year. I read the paper, I like the paper a lot of, and I invited to the authors to publish the paper in my journal. Because in my opinion was a very excellent paper tackling the important problems. The origin of the problem for authors. They explain what happened. We can find in the literature different data sets, and they collected four data sets with chest data set with lung images. What is the problem? You can check here the image. The images are quite different, and they collect images using different machines, different database, different infections, virus, bacteria, normal data set, but from different hospital, and they put together. And in particular, it's very well known, the COVID-X data set was the most popular. And the previous paper, this paper, used the COVID-X data set. What is the problem? People collect a data set from the internet with completely different characteristics, the different classes. And how to solve that? This guy, Italian guy, Maguolo and Nani, do the following experiment. It's very nice experiment. They remove the lungs from the image. they transform the original data sets, these four data sets, into data set without the links. You can check here. It's incredible. You can say, think, if we remove the links, it's impossible to detect the COVID. It's, of course, it theoretically is the correct hypothesis, but they use the deep learning classical algorithms and the detection of the COVID is 0.92, 92, 98, 99 in the different database. Really was possible to detect the COVID. Why? Because really the information was not in the lungs. The information was in the remaining part of the maze because really the lungs had no special characteristics to learn. Really, the differences between the image was in the characteristic, in the border of the image. Because if we collect image from different hospitals, you have different marks in the border of the image that where they were identified with the normal, with the virus, bacteria, and so on. And really, this is a clear example that of the beginning of my talk, bargage in, bargage out. And to take quality decision, is we need quality data. And this were not quality data. Really, the quality of the data was very bad. Really, the error, and the error that we need to avoid is to use the low quality data. We need quality data in order to extract knowledge. The problem of these people, the problem of these papers, and the problem of the database is that if people collect data from different sources in internet and they don't check the quality of the data, you can put together images from lungs, but the difference is really the information is not in the image in the lungs. The information may be, in this case, by the marks in the border, as you can check in this experiment. The experiment is very nice. Really, when I read this paper, I was surprised. It was a surprise for me because this result is like our results, in parallel our results. When we use the deep learning models from other authors, we obtain always the precision is very low because it's the problem. They learn from a low quality data set. And then when we use our data set, our original data set, of course, the model are not so useful. In fact, recently, a interesting paper published in the Nature Machine Intelligence, the new journal from ACM, this is also a very interesting publication, this publication, that analyze also what happened with the current study. And they explain, they discuss about the precipitation in studies. There are a lot of publication, but no real application where we are using image in COVID. Why? Because authors don't use a correct methodology for clinical validation. Basically now people are looking for data from internet, they put together the data and they are using low quality data to obtain the model. Of course, the text, the training versus text, the results are top results, but they have top results over low quality data. And then this study cannot be useful from a practical point of view. This is really an excellent case of study. The problem of the data quality for learning. In the COVID, when we started, of course, a lot of teams are starting to collect data, but they don't pay never attention to the quality of the data. And then the result, the conclusion are incorrect because they are using low quality data. Well, the central idea of my talk, we need more data quality for better knowledge. We need more and more data quality. It's fundamental, the quality of the data. The problem is not the size of the data. The problem is not if we have big data, we have a small data. The problem is we need to work towards the data quality, to use pre-processing, to analyze the quality, and then to have to use the smart data before, to have smart data before to use the learning. Some basic conclusion, of course, the quality data pre-processing techniques adapt the data and are fundamental now in data science. And of course, quality data processing is an essential part of any automatic learning process. And they include, of course, different kind of noise detection, data augmentation, and so on. And it is fundamental in deep learning. In contrast with the classical models, of course, the capacity, the abstraction capacity of CNNs is tremendous. Really, really, fortunately, with CNNs, it is possible to obtain high quality results, but we must pay attention that if the data are low quality data, as the previous example with the COVID, really the deep learning cannot solve the problem. You use low quality data and use deep learning, finally you have a low quality model. Then is fundamental the annotation, the labeling selection. The supervised deep learning depend a lot of on the part of the human annotation, the quality of the data and the collection, the data recollection. Of course, unfortunately, there are still not automatic methods to create small data. This is the most important limitation. And also in parallel, there are a lot of open research studies now towards data quality. Imbalance classification, for example, it needs pre-processing. What happens when we have noise in the data? What is the meaning of the noise in the image when we have the incorrect labels? And what is the correspondences between the data reduction in the classical machine learning for getting quality small data in deep learning? We have different challenge now that we need to solve and to answer now in order to have a complete pipeline, including data preprocessing and deep learning, transfer learning in the different problems. But always the most important, we have limitations associated to the techniques, but the most important, the data quality is fundamental. And I finish as I started. Quality decision are based on quality data. It's fundamental. In each new problem that we start to study, it's fundamental to analyze the data set. And it's very important how we got this new data set. It's fundamental. Now it's very easy to get a data set in internet and to have a lot of repository to get a data set. And it's very easy to write a paper because I pick up a data set, I read a model using this data set, I improve the model and I say, I have a top model in this problem. For example, I have a top model for COVID detection. But if you start working with a low quality data set, really your model is not useful. Then it's very important to pay attention to the data quality, all the process to get along the way to have the process, this data quality, the data processing, and to analyze and really to be sure that we have quality data before to take to use machine learning, transfer learning, and to take, of course, decision. Because if we have bad, low quality data, finally the decision will be low quality decision. Thank you very much. I finish my talk with a picture from Granada. I like Alhambra is a Muslim monument, and you can check here the snow. Really, we have a ski station 20 kilometers far from Granada, and really this image is very nice with the this in the winter is the classical image of Granada. You are welcome to visit us, Hamido. Visit us a lot of times, and I hope that after this terrible pandemic, we start again with normal life. Thank you very much. If you have any question, any comment.
Paco, thank you so much. So appreciated. You have excellent work, as I respect it very much. And I open for discussion. We have 10 minutes because I know you're very busy and I spent 1 hour with you before we discuss this lecture. So people who would like some questions, I'll be glad to open. You can go ahead if you have a question.
Okay. May I have a question? Because there is no possibility to raise a hand. Okay, my name is Bogumiła Chnatkowska and I'd like to ask, what do you think, could we obtain good quality data by artificial generation then? So it's possible to generate artificially good quality data.
Thank by your question. Yes, I think so. If you check, I am going back to my proposal, the models. Our model was the following. This was really, I was working with my team in the pandemic period. I remember I started in March last year with my team in contact with the doctors in the team of radiology team in the hospital. I remember we started in March the discussion of our project. The first step was to collect the data. But you can imagine terrible situation in all around the world and in Granada. Granada one of the cities with the COVID rates higher than in Spain. For in the hospital, unfortunately, they had a lot of patients in different 70 degree. But then we had the radiography, but the number finally was not so high. Because the problem was the doctor had no time for labeling the slide, because even at the beginning, remember the PCR proofs we had no in the hospital, and then we only use in our case image with a positive PCR proof with a complete guarantee that the positive was positive. The number of images was not so high, 400 positive, 400 negative was our initial data set. The data set was very small and was impossible to get top quality with the data set. Then our idea was first the image segmentation, because we were reading the literature and we found some results that was not so good. I remember some discussion with some colleagues, even in Spain, about the quality of the data. People call me, Paco, we have 95%. The problem is solved. We have 98. The problem is near to be solved. And said, no, it's impossible. Then first for us was the segmentation. Second, the documentation. In our case, we use it GANs. If you use the GANs and you guarantee, have the guarantee by the doctors that the image were correct, COVID positive versus COVID negative, we were using GAMS and we developed it, member of my team developed it, and a GAMS procedure to obtain new images. And we replicate the original emails and we replicate original versus negative, original versus positive GAMS. And we have different classes, negative, 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 positive, positive, negative, positive, positive. And then we were using 100 ends with the different arguments, with the different classes, and finally an ensemble to get the fusion of the 100 ends. But we use it GAMS, the generative models, artificial, the generative adversarial networks to get high quality data augmentation. In this case, because you know, you are using other. Remember this slide. For example, I am working now in another real problem with the agriculture ministry. A new problem we are starting with the goods, and we in some problems you can use the scaling, the centering, the translation, rotation, and so on. But in the case of the radiography, it's not possible to translate or to scale, to change, to rotate the image. It has no sense. with this image, it has no sense to rotate the image, depending on the problem. In this case, for us, our proposal was the GAMS. And really with the GAMS, we increased the number of instances of image, and really finally the model got top results. Particularly our result work, they were very consistent for doctors. In the severe case, the classification was 97% good, 85% the moderate, very good, and the doctor say us, 60% is perfect for me, because really when we have this case, it's so difficult to detect the COVID. Even for a doctor, this case, with only one or two regions with and a small white color in the lung, is so difficult for a doctor to detect the COVID. Then it's natural to have only 60%. He told me. Then really, these results are very, very consistent with the knowledge of the doctor, even with an level higher than the doctor. And fundamental for us was all the process, the small data process. This was the reason to call our model in this way. Segmentation and data augmentation with the GAMS. Then you have image. Now we have a project to detect different kind of goods. And our idea, we are starting another project. We receive the project now from the ministry. And I am working with our colleagues in the Royal Academy, Engineering Academy of Spain, and the specialist in the area of the on the forest conservation. Our idea is to detect what kind of the kind of the goods, and we are using rotation and transformation, but also our idea is to use GAMS in order to replicate the data set, the classes with low number of instance, because the problem really for us is that our data set has only a few number of cases of each one of the classes. Really was fundamental for us to use the GAMS. Now the theory of the GAMS is well developed, and really is a technology, and there are new algorithms that provide us the possibility to replicate, to increase the number of images in a problem.
Okay, thank you so much. So we can have some other question. Do you have?
Hello, Professor Herrera.
Yes.
Presentation, and it's an honor meeting you. I was wondering, honestly, because like I work a lot with generative methods, but for a generative cause, maybe more. Why can you say that data set is really enough? Because as you said, I'm working on industrial case for mechanical design, and I have used the data method. Way. Actually, for my case, I needed to integrate geometrical constraints, and I had to do the work manually at the beginning. So what I did, I manually labeled 4,000 design. But after that, I trained a deep learning model that learned to count, and then I predicted on the rest of the 20,000 samples I had. Okay, I did all my calculations, accuracy, validity, error squared, variances, and everything. And still what I did after the prediction, I took 1,000 predicted samples, recounted them manually to check that my model was in the accuracy range that is acceptable and that can be integrated. However, still one question always happens to me, like, when can I say it is enough? I can trust the model.
Very, very interesting question, thanks. As I said in my concluding remarks, there are still no automatic methods to create small data. It's proof and error, unfortunately, because if we have a very small data set, we have different techniques now to increase the design, data augmentation, GAMS, but finally, it's very important to have the text to discuss with the expert and perfect text data set and to check the error in the text. And it's very important that the experts must determine that the text data set is perfect representing all the possible scenario in the problem. and then you need to prove and you need to run to get the smart data to use the transfer learning. And if your error in the text is high, probably the problem is not in the model. The problem is in the origin of the data because you have the well-known problem of lack of data. There is a very interesting paper was published some time ago in the area of imbalance classification. One experiment, Stephanie Jakovic is the author, is a well-known and recognized author in the imbalance machine learning scenario. And really, they the experiment was a classical data set and they started with subset. It's very easy to start with a global data set to work with the 90%, 80%, 70%, until the 10%. And when you run your algorithms, you can check that you change the level of accuracy when you are increasing the size of the data set. And in one point, you have similar, you can get similar result than the original one because you have enough data. But unfortunately, a priori, we don't know how many real data we need. This is the real problem. You need to check, for example, if you have a few data set, you can use future learning. You have new techniques now for in this kind of scenario. But I have now the same problem. I have my real problem with good. I have 40 classes of good. The results are very good now, but we can increase the problem until 400 classes. And will be so difficult to obtain a lot of image for different goods. And we have the same problem that you in the future. The project is 2 years progress. We receive a good project from the ministry with it to I will hire two collaborators in the project to develop the experiments. And I am worried now because probably for some classes I will have a few images. I am very worried because they say my colleagues from Madrid say now is amazing your results 99% with 40 classes is excellent. We will have a perfect project, but the problem now I have 40 classes, and I am very worried because with 400 classes the result will not be the same. I need to develop new data preprocessing techniques, new GAMs, and I am very worried now because the expectation is tremendous. My colleagues say, wow, you are fantastic. Your artificial intelligence tools are fantastic. But no, because in the future, my artificial intelligence tools will not be fantastic because the data set will have problem. This is the real problem always. Prove an error and trying to create artificial instance similar to original ones to increase the quality. But always we will have an error impossible to reduce if we don't increase the original data with quality data.
Ironic, but when I first started doing this deep learning model that counts bars, first the quality was really bad and I was complaining to my professor, it's not working. And then I labeled extra data, and then I labeled a lot. It took weeks to have labeled data. After that, I said, I'm so worried. The deep learning model is doing so good. He said, you're worried. We're worried in both times because we're not sure if it's really understand what it's doing. So that's the problem.
Another problem, you need to check if the some problems sometimes are the error in the labeling. If you have some image with error in the label, it's terrible.
Human edit, of course.
It's very important. I am working with a PhD student now in the analysis of the error with the noise, the noise label. And now we are working developing some models that we modify the logs function in order to reduce the problem of the error, and we are filtering. You need to check, you need to filter the original data. It's very important. First, to have the guarantee that you have top quality data.
Yes,
second, it's fundamental. You have not top quality data, original ones. You use documentation. If you have poor data, the documentation produce very, very low data quality data set. And then it's fundamental to guarantee, to check the quality, the quality of the original data, to use the documentation technique, to know what is the error threshold, and go back probably and to ask to the expert, sorry, we need more data, or try to develop GAMS, a new documentation technique for your problem. There are some library of documentation, Microsoft, another company, are now providing top library with the documentation, but you always will have the limitation of the data, of course.
Okay, thank you so much, Professor Herrera. Paco, thank you so much, Paco. I have a present for you, and I don't, this one. So I
yes, very nice.
But I want to bring it myself, not to send it yes, by post.
I hope.
I have vaccination, and you have vaccination. So I have a passport of COVID pass. Then we have the chance to see and celebrate the Christmas in Granada with this
I hope to receive you in at the beginning of the year. I hope we are near. With the vaccine, we are near to reduce, I hope, the pandemic problem and to start with a meeting face to face. It's very important the relation face to face. I am very tired, like all us, working online.
Okay,
thank you very much.
It was a pleasure. Thank you so much, Paco. So appreciated. Thank you, everybody. And we still have one session. I do appreciate Paco so much again. Bye bye.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye bye. Thank you, everybody. So we will have another session. It was very exciting to see Marco with us today. He's Superman.